Good evening. Welcome to this evening's special and somber worship service for Good Friday. It is during this worship service that we remember Christ's perfect and atoning sacrifice for the forgiveness of our sins. This evening we also have the opportunity to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. If you've been baptized into a Christian church in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, if you confess your sins and you understand that Christ alone can save you from them, and if you are seeking to live with Him as Lord of your life, then during the time of the service where we celebrate, we invite you to join in with us. As we go into the service, would you please join me in a brief word of prayer? Holy and loving God, as we prepare to set aside our busyness and to focus intently on Jesus' suffering and death, we ask for eyes to see all of the amazing things that Jesus' death means for understanding you, your love, and our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand for our responsive call to worship. This call to worship comes from John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his own dearly beloved Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. On this day of remembrance and hope, we declare with joy, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save it. Let us worship God. We begin our worship this evening by singing together What Wondrous Love. It's found in the Gray Hymnal, number 379. Let's sing together.
Laid aside his crown for my soul, for my soul.
seated. I invite you now to join me in this responsive prayer, which is found in your bulletins. O crucified Jesus, Son of the Father, conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, eternal Word of God, we worship you. O crucified Jesus, holy temple of God, dwelling place of the Most High, gate of heaven, burning flame of love, we worship you. O crucified Jesus, sanctuary of justice and love, full of kindness, source of all faithfulness, we worship you. O crucified Jesus, ruler of every heart, in you are the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. In you dwells all the fullness of the Godhead. We worship you. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Almighty God, look with mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and to be given over to the hands of sinners and to suffer death on the cross. Through him, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The first reading comes from Luke 22, verses 1 through 16. Now the feast of unleavened bread, called the Passover, was approaching. And the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some way to get rid of Jesus, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered Judas, called Iscariot, one of the 12. And Judas went to the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard and discussed with them how he might betray Jesus. They were delighted and agreed to give him money. He consented and watched for an opportunity to hand Jesus over to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of unleavened bread in which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." "Where do you want us to prepare for it?" they asked. He replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asked, where is the guest room? Where may I eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, so they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you because before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Luke 22, verse 39 through 53. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and he prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." While he was still speaking, a crowd came up, and the man who was called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus asked him, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" When Jesus' followers saw what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with our swords?" And one of them struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus answered, "No more of this." And he touched the man's ear, and he healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come for him, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come with swords and clubs? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me. But this is your hour, when darkness reigns." The word of the Lord.
We respond by singing together, "Go to Dark Gethsemane." Please stand. Please join me now in this responsive reading from Luke 22. You'll find the words printed in your bulletin. "Then seizing him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance. And when some there had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him seated there in the firelight. She looked closely at him and said, 'This man was with him,' but he denied it. 'Woman, I don't know him,' he said. A little later, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." "Man, I am not," Peter replied. About an hour later, another asserted, "Certainly this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean." Peter replied, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." Just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. "Before the rooster crows today, you will disown me 3 times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This reading is from Luke 22, verse 66, going into chapter 23. At daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests and the teachers of the law, met together, and Jesus was led before them. "If you are the Christ," they said, "tell us." Jesus answered, "If I tell you, you will not believe me, and if I asked you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God." They all asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He replied, "You are right in saying I am." Then they said, "Why do we need any more testimony? We have heard it from his own lips." And then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Christ, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. And then down to verse 13, Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us, as you can see. He has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." With one voice, they cried out, "Away with this man, release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." For the third time, he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I will have him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. This is the word of the Lord.
Please join us now in singing "The Power of the Cross." You'll find the words printed in your bulletin. Please stand.
Oh, to see the dawn. Took the blame.
This reading is from Luke 23, verse 32 through 46. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the other criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was written a notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he said this, he breathed his last. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please join me in a brief word of prayer. Lord and Heavenly Father, it's almost too much for us to bear. We know this story. It's hard to hear because we have a role in it. But we ask, Lord, that you would help us to hear this story, that we might confess our role in it, that you, Lord Jesus, might save us from our sins. By your work, Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Jesus hangs on a cross, being crucified in excruciating pain after having been tortured and tormented. He hangs there with his arms nailed, most likely through the wrist, as was the custom, and has to pull himself up for every individual breath. This is the Jesus who had avoided temptation in the wilderness, though he was tempted directly by the devil in areas where he was physically weak at the time, in areas toward his strength and knowledge of Scripture, in areas of his very identity in following Jesus, or in following his God and Father. Lord, in these ways, our Lord had been tempted and yet had remained without sin. The devil left him, and from there, his ministry began in earnest. He began preaching and teaching and telling the good news that there is restoration that can be had, reconciliation between you and God and with one another. And he performed all of these miracles. He had all of this good news to share. And he had it for even those who were the lowliest and the outcasts. That God has a place for those of us who feel pushed aside. And as his popularity grew and the crowds grew and the fervor around him grew, his enemies grew more and more concerned. And so it came to pass that Jesus came into Jerusalem on a Sunday, and the fervor of the crowds that were there to celebrate the Passover shouted, "Hosanna, save us, Hosanna in the highest." And they blessed him, and they loved him, and they turned on him in less than a week. The crowds that had wanted him to start a revolt, to overthrow the Romans, to be king in a very literal sense, physically on earth, to reign from Jerusalem, when it became evident that that is not what Jesus was there to do, he became frustrated. And the powerful enemies that Christ had saw this as an opportunity and stirred up fervor among the crowds. And so those same folks who were shouting Hosanna were shouting crucify him. They're not the only folks who had a powerful reaction that we've read about in the past few passages of Scripture. They shouted, crucify him, because he wasn't going to do what they wanted. And Pilate had a response. He knew Jesus was innocent. But we read from other places in Scripture that these rulers, these enemies of Jesus, came to Pilate and said, he says he's king. He's the Son of God. And if you let him go, what does that say about your loyalty to the emperor? So do what we want and have him crucified, or we will let the people who are higher up on the food chain than you know about it, and you will suffer. And so faced with this decision between an innocent man's life and looking out for his own skin, Pilate acquiesced to the crowd. We later read that the rulers sneered at him, that the soldiers mocked him. All of these horrendous responses to who Jesus was and is, to what he was experiencing, they still exist in the world today. There are those who threaten followers of Jesus their very lives because they will proclaim Jesus as Lord. Crowds and mobs who threaten our brothers and sisters in places in this world. There are those who acquiesce and allow it to happen. There are those who see Jesus and all that he calls us to and asks of us, and then think of themselves and decide, I'm going to look out for me. There are those who sneer and those who mock that the Lord himself would come, die, and rise again. This seems too far-fetched and too much of a fairy tale. All of these responses still exist in the world today. They're not the only responses, but they are there. And what is troubling is they all exist in our hearts as well. We have maybe never physically shouted at Jesus that we want him crucified, but we, each and every one of us, have looked at how Jesus hasn't had our life turn out the way that we would like, and we can't seem to get Jesus to bend his will toward ours, so we go off on our own path. That when it looks difficult to follow Christ, we look out for ourselves and do what it is we want when we want. And we don't need anyone to hold us accountable. We'll be just fine, thank you. Perhaps we've not sneered directly at Jesus or mocked him to his face, but what is sin but sneering at a Savior? What is sin but mocking our very Maker? These are not the only responses. The ones that we focus most intently on this evening are the two criminals who were there, who had a couple things in common. Both of them professed that this was no ordinary man they were being crucified with. One goes and says, "You're the Messiah, aren't you?" The other one goes on and says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." They profess. They know the answer. They understand he's somehow different. They have another thing in common. They are quite literally in close proximity to Jesus. We don't know exactly 10 feet, 12 feet, less than that, a little bit more, but we know that even though it was painful to breathe, they somehow found the breath to speak to one another and could hear and understand each other. But the small, subtle difference between these two criminals ought to give us pause. And in a few moments, it ought to frighten us deeply. Because there's this criminal who professes that Jesus is the Messiah, knows the Sunday school answer, and is close to Christ. But his response to Jesus being crucified is, "Do this thing for me," as if he is entitled to it. It is blasphemous. It is sinful. It is selfish and broken. The difference is that this second criminal rebukes the first and then says this, "We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve." This second criminal confesses. He is in close proximity to Christ. He professes that Jesus is different, is the King, is the Messiah. But he begins with what we must all understand, that this good news of the gospel of Christ's death and resurrection begins here. It begins with bad news. The bad news is, you did this. This is your fault. This is my fault. And we have to confess this. But the good news of the gospel does not end there. It goes on. Because this sacrament that reminds us of his perfect sinless sacrifice is not something that you deserve. It is not something that I deserve. There is no way that we can earn it. But the good news of the gospel is this, that it is here for you tonight, and you can accept it, and you can accept the grace of Christ. We'll take a moment now of silence. We'll confess our sins to God. We'll admit to him and to ourselves that this is because of us. And then take a moment to reflect on the amazing gift of Christ's sacrifice for you. and take time to be grateful for this gift that you do not deserve, but have the opportunity to freely accept anyway. Join me in a moment of silence. Lord, we put you there. Maybe not literally, but we put you there all the same. This is our fault. It's because of our sin. And yet this was also all part of your plan. We do not deserve the grace that you pour out on us, but we desperately need it. And so, like that second criminal, we ask that you remember us when you come into your kingdom, and we take heart the words that you gave to him then on that day. Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Lord Jesus, may it be so, because of your great love, because of your grace. Amen. Would you please join me in a litany for the Lord's Supper? Why do we give thanks and praise before this table? We give thanks for God's work of creation, liberation, and salvation. It is indeed right, our duty and delight, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Holy Lord, eternal God. You created the heavens and the earth and all that is in them. You made us in your own image, and in countless ways you showed us your mercy. All glory and blessing are yours, O Holy God, for in your mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ. He took our human nature and suffered death on the cross for our temptation. Here he made a perfect sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. We praise you that before he suffered, died, our Savior gave us this holy sacrament and continued us until he comes again. Why do we eat bread at this table? The night before he died, Jesus took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Why do we drink from the cup at this table? The same night, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And what do we remember at this table? Remember God's gracious love for us, Christ's death and resurrection for us, and the Spirit's tender care for us. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Merciful God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and of the cup, that in eating and drinking we may be made one with Christ and one another. Amen. Thank you. Take, eat, remember, and believe that the body of Jesus Christ was broken for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. Take, drink, remember, and believe that the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. A reading from Luke chapter 23, verses 50 through 56. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes. But they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment.
Please remain seated as we sing together, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." You can find it in the red hymnal, number 324.
Would you stand, please, for a parting blessing? God, go before you to lead you. God, go behind you to defend you. God, go beneath you to support you. God, go beside you to befriend you. Do not be afraid. May the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you. Do not be afraid. Go in peace.
Please depart in silence.